Welcome back, everyone. Today we're going to continue or finish Lecture 4.1, America and the Road to World War II. Now, last time we left off, FDR had just given Great Britain 50 World War I era destroyers. Now, the election of 1940 is approaching, and FDR decided to seek an unprecedented third term. Now, at this time, there was no constitutional prohibition against a third term. But the tradition established by George Washington was that two terms was enough for one man. Seeking more than two terms was almost blasphemous. It was kind of a way of saying one was better and wiser than the father of his country. FDR's opponent in the election was the businessman Wendell Willkie. Willkie was a corporate attorney and utilities executive. Though he supported much of the New Deal, he did emerge as a leading spokesman for the business community, who felt aggrieved by some of the more onerous elements of the New Deal. One of the most interesting things about Willkie was that he had only recently become a Republican. He had spent most of his adult life as a registered Democrat. Former Indiana Republican Senator James E. Watson summed it up best when he heard that the GOP had nominated a former Democrat for president. He said this: "If a whore repented and wanted to join the church, I'd personally welcome her and lead her up the aisle to a pew. But by the eternal, I'd not ask her to lead the choir the first night." So that's kind of how Republicans react to this. Now, Willkie was an internationalist who publicly criticized the Nazis. Because he and Roosevelt held similar views on internationalism, foreign policy differences were not a big part of the campaign. There was a selective service bill making its way through Congress during the campaign for the election. Someone told Willkie that, quote, "If you want to win the election, you will come out against the proposed draft." And Willkie shot back, "I would rather not win the election than do that." So Willkie supports FDR's measures to kind of prepare America for the possibility of entering World War II. That bill was the Burke-Wadsworth Selective Service Act. It passed in September 1940, so the same month as the Destroyers Deal. FDR and Willkie both supported it. Some 16 million men ages 21 through 35 were registered on the draft rolls as a result. Upon winning the nomination for the Democrats, FDR made some important changes. He dropped his previous vice president, John Nance Garner, and he selected Agricultural Secretary Henry Wallace to be his running mate. FDR also sought to avoid the mistakes made by Woodrow Wilson. If you remember, during World War I, after the war, Wilson refused to reach out to Republicans during the Paris Peace Conference, and he was very hostile towards them during the debate over the League of Nations. So FDR doesn't want to do that. Now, just days before the GOP nominated Willkie, FDR named two prominent Republicans to his cabinet. He named Frank Knox as Secretary of the Navy and Henry L. Stimson as Secretary of War. FDR ended up winning the election. He promised to keep America out of war, you know, similar to what Wilson promised in 1916. There's a famous speech he gives in Boston before the election. FDR says, quote, "I have said this before, but I shall say it again and again. Your boys are not going to be sent into any foreign wars." When Willkie heard that over the radio, he exploded, shouting, "That hypocritical son of a bitch, this is going to beat me." So FDR promises, "I will not send Americans into war no matter what." When the election results came, FDR won a huge victory, but it was his most narrow victory so far. He received 55% of the votes, and he did beat Willkie by more than 5 million votes. But as you can see, he doesn't win as big as he did in 1936. Unemployment was down thanks to war production jobs providing Britain's weapons to fight Hitler. This helped FDR, but probably the reason he got reelected is Americans didn't want to change presidents in the midst of the greatest international crisis of the 20th century. After the election, Churchill cabled Roosevelt, quote, "I prayed for your success. I'm truly thankful for it. Things are afoot which will be remembered as long as the English language is spoken in any quarter of the globe." Now, after the election, Britain faced a serious problem. She was going broke, so she wasn't going to have the cash to buy weapons to kind of fight Hitler. So what ended up happening is FDR kind of racked his brain to think, how can I get weapons to Britain now that they're broke? And he came up with something called Lend-Lease, and this is how FDR described it. It's kind of a famous parable he tells. FDR said, if you had a neighbor that had a house and their house was on fire, and they asked you, can I borrow your garden hose to put out the fire? You wouldn't charge them for the garden hose. You wouldn't argue about the price for using the hose. You would simply lend them your garden hose, and they would put out their fire. When the fire was over, they would give you your hose back, and everything would be fine. Now, the problem with this is when you lend Great Britain tanks and airplanes and weapons, you don't get those back. They get blown up. They get destroyed. So the analogy doesn't quite work very well. So FDR kind of tells the American public that in December of 1940. Later in that month, he gives a famous fireside chat, and he says, if Britain goes down, the Axis powers will control the continent of Europe, Asia, Africa, Australasia, and the high seas, and they will be in a position to bring enormous military and naval resources against this hemisphere. It is not exaggeration to say that all of us in all the Americas would be living at the point of a gun. So to prevent that, FDR said, we must have more ships, more guns, more planes, more of everything. We must be the great arsenal of democracy. So that phrase, the arsenal of democracy, is the idea that we will provide the tanks, the airplanes, the guns, the trucks to win World War II. FDR continued, the nations already fighting Hitler do not ask us to do their fighting. They ask us for the implements of war. We must get these weapons to them in sufficient volume and quickly enough so that we and our children will be saved the agony and suffering of war, which others have had to endure. Now, Lend-Lease required congressional authorization, and a great debate followed. FDR started that debate in January of 1941. He gives his annual message to Congress, and he defined four essential liberties or freedoms that he was trying to protect: the freedom of speech, the freedom of religion, the freedom from fear, and the freedom from want. Now, in response to FDR's Lend-Lease, the America First Committee swung into action. This was an isolationist organization that had been formed the year before in the aftermath of the Destroyers for Bases deal. Gerald Nye and Charles Lindbergh both spoke out against Lend-Lease, and I want to show you a couple clips, one of Gerald Nye and one of America First.
Like so many Americans, I too am wishing for victory for one side engaged in Europe. But I'm wishing more than for that. For the avoidance for my country of the waste, the cost, the debt, the futility, the deaths, the cripples, and the heartbreak that can be America's only reward for participation in another European mess.
I come before you at this time to enter a plea for American independence. It is amazing that one should have to plead for American independence in a nation with a heritage such as ours, in a nation which in its infancy revolted against foreign control, and whose people have fought time and time again against the armies and interference of the old world. Yet the independence and the destiny of America were never more in jeopardy than they are today. Why, with 130 million people, are we being told that we must give up our independent position, that our frontiers lie in Europe, and that our destiny will be decided by European armies fighting on European soil? What has happened to this nation that it fears in maturity the forces that it conquered in its youth? What change has come over us? What foreign influence has sprung up among us? Where is the blood of such leaders as Washington, Jefferson, and Lincoln? Blood that stood firm on American soil against the threats, the armies, and the navies of the greatest empires on earth. What we lack today is the type of leadership that made us a great nation. We do not question the need for rearmament, for reform, for a better economic system. What we do question is the leadership that has brought these conditions upon us. We question that the men who were unable to see these conditions in time to avoid them who could not foresee the war in time to prepare for it, who refused to believe the reports of rearming abroad when there was still time for action, are now competent to carry this nation successfully through a period of great crisis. Under their leadership, we have alienated one after another the most powerful military nations of both Europe and Asia. At a time when we ourselves are unprepared for action, and while the people of our nation are overwhelmingly opposed to war. There is no question about the fundamental courage and solidarity of Americans when our national welfare is at stake. There is no division among us about the defense of our own country. We have always been ready to fight against the interference of foreign powers in our affairs. If need be, we are ready to die for the independence of America, as our forefathers have died before us when necessity arose. On a clearly American issue, we stand a united nation. It is only when we are asked to take part in the quarrels of foreign countries that we divide. Only when we are asked to merge our destiny with that of foreign lands. Only when an attempt is made to transfer loyalty for America to loyalty for some other nation. The fact is today that we are divided. We have not confidence in our leaders. We have not confidence in their efficiency or in their judgment. Instead of a Washington warning us against the wiles of foreign influence and excessive partiality for any nation, we are told that our frontiers lie in Europe. We do not need untold thousands of military aircraft unless we intend to wage a war abroad. What we do need is a thoroughly modern and efficient Air Corps, trained, equipped, and maintained for the specific mission of American defense. What we need even more, however, is balanced action, a clear-cut plan, and a consistent attitude. Adequate defense does not necessitate this alarm and confusion. With intelligent leadership, we could have built an impregnable defense for America without disturbing seriously our national life and industry. We have already spent more than enough money to have done this. With an army, a navy, and an air corps of high quality and reasonable size, we could have maintained our position with safety at home and respect abroad. But today, while we listen to talk of aircraft, guns, and battleships, couched in figures so astronomical that they compare only with our national debt, we find ourselves in confusion at home and under ridicule abroad. All the lessons of Europe have passed unheeded before us. The effort that should have been devoted to the welfare of our own nation has been spread ineffectively over difficulties of the other parts of the world. The attention that should have been concentrated on the defense of America has been divided by a controversy over what part we should take in the wars of Europe. If we desire strength and freedom and independence for our country, the first step must be to assure ourselves of leadership which is entirely and unequivocally American. When a man is drafted to serve in the armed forces of our country, he has the right to know that his government has the independent destiny of America as its objective, and that he will not be sent to fight in the wars of foreign lands. The doctrine that we must enter the wars of Europe in order to defend America will be fatal to our nation if we follow it. When men are called upon to fight and die for their country, there must not be even the remotest question of foreign influence involved.
All right, others also criticized Lend-Lease. Montana Senator Burton Wheeler said that Lend-Lease was, quote, AAA foreign policy. It will plow under every fourth American boy. Now, part of the debate over Lend-Lease centered around whether or not the U.S. Navy would escort this Lend-Lease aid across the Atlantic. Congress included legislation that prohibited escorts taking this stuff to Europe. The Lend-Lease Act passed in March 1941, 60-31 in the Senate and 317-71 in the House. So Congress wants to also aid the democracies or Great Britain fighting Hitler. The New York Times hailed the passage of the Lend-Lease as, quote, the day when the United States ended the Great Retreat, which began with the Senate rejection of the Treaty of Versailles and the League of Nations. Our efforts to find security in isolation has failed. By the final passage of the Lend-Lease bill, we confess its failure. Churchill called it the most unsordid act in the history of any nation. Now, this is where the arsenal of democracy swings into action. Congress authorized $7 billion in Lend-Lease aid to Great Britain, and then they upped defense spending to $13.7 billion for the Army and the Navy before 1941 was out. This helped pull America out of the Great Depression, so this great spending on defense. David M. Kennedy says in Freedom from Fear, quote, that rising tide of military spending began at last to float the wallowing hulk of the economy out of the slough of depression. As nearly 1 million draftees filed into hastily hammered, green-timbered military training camps, and as war orders poured into big industrial centers, unemployment sank below 10% for the first time in more than a decade. So the New Deal failed to end the Great Depression, but now we have defense production for World War II finally bringing unemployment down below 10%. Now, despite a ban on convoys taking this Lend-Lease aid to Britain, Lend-Lease aid did lead to an undeclared shooting war in the Atlantic between America and Germany. Germany had a U-boat blockade around Great Britain, and Americans didn't want to get dragged into war because of an incident at sea. But what FDR ended up doing is he just kept extending the American security zone, the coastal security zone, farther and farther out into the Atlantic towards Europe. So basically, he was making the area that American ships could sail larger and larger. So America would patrol these waters. They wouldn't fight German submarines, but if they saw a German submarine, they would tell the British ships and the British airplanes where they were, and then the British would go sink the German subs. In April 1941, FDR sends troops to occupy Greenland. In June 1941, he sends troops to occupy Iceland. The Selective Service Act that had been passed said you could not send American troops outside the Western Hemisphere. So FDR kept extending the definition of the Western Hemisphere. So technically, he wasn't breaking it, even though he was breaking the law. Now, there were a number of incidents in the Atlantic, but the Greer incident is what changed things. In September 1941, the U.S. destroyer Greer was proceeding towards Iceland. The Greer and a British plane had been tracking a German U-boat, U-652. The British plane dropped some depth charges and then flew away. The Germans then fired on the Greer because they knew the Greer was helping to sink them. The German U-boat missed, and then the Greer retaliated by dropping depth charges, but also missed. So nobody was blown up, but FDR used this incident to institute a shoot-on-sight policy. So now American ships and planes in the Atlantic are allowed to attack German U-boats. So there's not an official war, but there's an undeclared shooting war now between Germany and America. This shoot-on-sight policy escalated the undeclared war in the Atlantic, leading to the first American casualties in World War II, in Europe anyways. On October 17th, the U.S. destroyer Kearney was torpedoed en route to Iceland, and 11 American sailors were killed. In October 1941, the USS Reuben James was hit by a torpedo. It broke in two and sank. 115 sailors were killed. Now, despite the dangers lurking in the Atlantic, in August 1941, FDR and Churchill had an important meeting where they got together. They met in Placentia Bay offshore of Argentia off of Newfoundland. The two talked strategy. They issued a joint declaration. They held a church service on board the American cruiser Augusta. I have a clip of that service, and I want to show you just a little clip of them singing. Now, an important document came out of the meeting called the Atlantic Charter. It was an announcement of what the war was being fought for. Even though America is not yet in the war, this is what America would support. It pledged America and Great Britain to seek a post-war world that would honor the principles of self-determination, free trade, non-aggression, and freedom of the seas. So similar things that Wilson's 14 points called for. What eventually gets America into war is Japan. So as 1941 drew to a close, we're going to see America finally go to war. What basically led the Japanese to attack at Pearl Harbor was the situation in the Pacific in 1941. Japan and America were at odds over Japan's invasion of China in 1937. Japan was also potentially going to invade French Indochina, the Dutch East Indies, British Singapore, and other areas in Southeast Asia. Japan's war machine depended on materials from America: scrap iron, steel, iron, high-grade aviation fuel, and most importantly, oil. America faced a tough decision. They could cut off the Japanese supply of these materials and limit Japan's war machine, so stop Japan from invading other countries. However, the problem with this approach is that it actually might cause Japan to invade more countries rather than stop them from invading. Southeast Asia, the Dutch East Indies, all those places, they're good sources of those supplies that Japan gets from America, especially oil. So if America cuts those supplies off, Japan might actually invade more area just to secure their ability to make war. Now, the other choice America had was to continue negotiating with Japan, not cutting off their supplies and hopefully keeping them contained. But a series of escalations, though, would lead to Japan deciding to go to war. Seeking to keep Japan restrained, FDR enacted an embargo in July 1940, so more than a year before the war. The embargo cut Japan's source of scrap iron, steel, and high-octane aviation fuel. After the fall of France, Japan moved into the northern part of French Indochina. Then Japan officially joined the Axis powers by signing the Tripartite Pact. This was an agreement aimed at the United States. It basically said that Germany and Italy would come to Japan's aid if they were attacked by the United States. FDR responded to the Tripartite Act with another embargo in September 1940, this time aimed at all of Japan's iron and steel supplies. In December 1940, FDR added iron ore and pig iron to the list of embargo items. In January 1941, he added copper and brass. The Japanese war machine was not stopped by any of this, but the Japanese worry that FDR might eventually add oil to the embargo, and if Japan's oil is cut off, then they can't make war. As Japanese and Americans negotiated, the international situation changed. Hitler invaded the Soviet Union in June of 1941. This is known to history as Operation Barbarossa. This invasion was very successful, and it looked as if Japan's traditional enemy, Russia, might collapse. So this created a debate in Japan over a northern and a southern strategy. Northern strategy activists called for using Hitler's invasion as an opportunity also to invade the Soviet Union and capture in a two-front war. Southern strategy activists called for an invasion into Southeast Asia now that Japan's flank, which is Russia, was occupied with Hitler's invasion. The Southern strategists eventually won out. In July 1941, Japanese troops invaded southern French Indochina. FDR responded by issuing a freeze of Japanese assets in the United States and required any further Japanese purchases to be cleared through a government committee. Now, later on, FDR was out of the country, and Washington officials turned this freeze into a complete embargo, so Japan's oil was finally shut off. This was the turning point. Without oil, Japan could only operate her war machine for 18 months. So she had 18 months supply on hand. She needed a new source of oil. Japan continued to negotiate, and in November 1941, they sent a seasoned diplomat, Saburo Kurusu, to help with the negotiations in Washington. The Japanese government decided that if an agreement was not reached by November 26th, the attack on Pearl Harbor would take place. Japan believed that if they could knock out America's Pacific Fleet, she would have free reign in the Pacific, and America might have to accept a negotiated settlement. So basically, Japan would rule the Pacific. On November 26, Secretary of State Cordell Hull gave the Japanese diplomats a 10-point list of American positions or American demands. It basically said that the Japanese had to withdraw from China, something that they were not willing to do. So that settled it. The Japanese carrier force set out from Japan to attack Pearl Harbor at the end of November. Now, the attack was masterminded by Admiral Yamamoto. He was the commander-in-chief of Japan's combined fleet. Yamamoto was well acquainted with America. He had studied at Harvard in the 1920s, and he later served as a naval attaché in Washington. He knew the vast power of the United States lay in its large industrial base and large population. After the November 26th deadline passed, a Japanese strike force led by Vice Admiral Chuichi Nagumo sailed the 3,500 miles from Japan to Pearl Harbor. They did this in complete radio silence. On December 7, 1941, some 350 aircraft from six Japanese aircraft carriers flew in two waves towards Pearl Harbor. They damaged or sunk 18 American ships, including eight battleships. They destroyed over 180 aircraft on the ground and crippled another 120. They killed over 2,400 Americans, including 1,100 that died on the battleship Arizona, which blew up when a bomb exploded in its forward magazine. The next day, Monday, December 8th, 1941, FDR went before Congress and asked for a declaration of war, and I want you to watch that clip now.
Senators and representatives, I have the distinguished honor of presenting the President of the United States.
Mr. Vice President, Mr. Speaker, members of the Senate and of the House of Representatives, and at the solicitation of Japan, was still in conversation with its government and its emperor, looking toward the maintenance of peace in the Pacific. The attack yesterday on the Hawaiian Islands has caused severe damage to American naval and military forces. I regret to tell you that very many American lives have been lost. In addition, American ships have been reported torpedoed on the high seas between San Francisco and Honolulu. As Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy, I have directed that all measures be taken for our defense, but always will our whole nation remember the character of the onslaught against us. No matter how long it may take us to overcome this premeditated invasion, the American people in their righteous might will win through to absolute victory. I believe that I interpret the will of the Congress and of the people when I assert that we will not only defend ourselves to the uttermost, but will make it very certain that this form of treachery shall never again endanger us. Hostilities exist. There is no blinking at the fact that our people, our territory, and our interests are in grave danger. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph. So help us God. I ask that the Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
Okay, so was Pearl Harbor a success for the Japanese and an unalterable setback for the Americans? The biggest success at Pearl Harbor was that the sinking of the American battleships. However, battleships were the weapons of the last war. The Japanese failed to attack the American aircraft carriers, the weapons of this war, which were away from Pearl Harbor during the attack. The Japanese also failed to destroy the oil tanker facility that fueled the American Navy. The destroying of this facility probably would have forced the American Navy back to the West Coast, but the Japanese did not do this. David M. Kennedy writes in Freedom from Fear, quote, "The simple fact is that Pearl Harbor was a masterful, though incomplete, tactical achievement by the Japanese. It would also prove in time to have been a strategic blunder and a political and psychological catastrophe." Basically, and this quote is pretty famous, Japan only succeeded in waking a sleeping giant, which is America. Admiral Yamamoto had stated that after attacking America, quote, "I shall run wild for the first 6 months or a year, but I have utterly no confidence for the second or third year." The reason for this is that he knew America's industrial might, once thrown into battle, would be impossible to overcome. And a great point illustrates this. In the 2 years following the attack on Midway, Midway's a battle going to come up in a little while, the Japanese built six more aircraft carriers. So in 2 years, they built six aircraft carriers. In that same period, America built 17 carriers, 10 medium carriers, and 86 escort carriers. So the Japanese built six aircraft carriers, and we build well over 100. The United States could just outproduce Japan and win the war. Winston Churchill remembered the feeling he had after learning of the attack on Pearl Harbor. This is what he wrote many years later. Quote, "So we had won after all. Hitler's fate was sealed. Mussolini's fate was sealed. As for the Japanese, they would be ground to powder. There was no more doubt about the end." Being saturated and satiated with emotion and sensation, I went to bed and slept the sleep of the saved and the thankful. On December 11th, 1941, so 4 days after Pearl Harbor, Hitler and Mussolini declared war on the United States, even though they were not required to by the Tripartite Pact, because Japan had attacked America, not the other way around. Now, this was a huge blunder, because it allowed FDR to throw the weight of America's industrial and military might against the Axis in Europe. FDR may have had a difficult time declaring war on Germany after Pearl Harbor. He would have had an even more difficult time in pursuing a Europe-first strategy with the whole country clamoring for vengeance